Amen. Praise the name of the Lord, everybody. It's good to be able to minister the word of the Lord and to try to do my best to give you a word that would open your understanding. You know, it doesn't matter what word we preach from time to time. We know that the Lord gives it to us and that it is food for our soul. It is definitely something that our spirit needs. Our spirit needs the preached word of God, the message of God. The Bible says that by the foolishness of preaching, that God chose this to save them that believe. And so I'm thankful to have this opportunity to minister the word of the Lord and just kind of share some things with you. I don't know exactly how my delivery will be, but we'll do our best nonetheless in Jesus' name. And so I pray this message just finds you well. I pray that you're doing okay. And to God be the glory. I know that revival will continue to remain in our church. And God will use us, amen, to the best of our abilities that we would be so willing to allow him. And so again, I pray this message finds you well, feeling better and encouraged in Jesus' name. I'm going to be reading in Psalms 56, and I'll begin reading at verse 3 and 4. Psalms 56, verses 3 and 4. And the Word of God reads, "What time I am afraid, I will trust in thee. In God I will praise his word. In God I have put my trust. I will not fear what flesh can do unto me." Amen. I want to read that last verse in verse number 4. It's not the last verse, but it's the last verse of my text. And it says, "In God I will praise his word. In God I have put my trust. I will not fear what flesh can do unto me." Amen. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for all that you're doing in our midst, for your continual protection and love that is upon us, your mercy that is everlasting, O God. Lord, we pray right now, Lord Jesus, that you would anoint my lips, anoint my words, O God, that would minister grace unto the listeners, O Lord Jesus, that would bless your people, Lord, to bring forth fruit unto your glory, that would open our understanding, Lord, that we can see what you want us to see in the Spirit, God, and have that understanding that this only the Spirit can give us, O God. Lord, we love you and we give you praise right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Verse number 4 in our text says, "In God I will praise his word. What time I am afraid, I will trust in thee, Lord. In God I will praise his word." And that's something that most definitely we should all do. We should praise the word of God. We should put our trust in the word of God. And here the psalmist says that in God I have put my trust. And, you know, trusting is a word that's easier said than done. A lot of people tend to think that they trust in God until everything begins to run out, until all your resources are gone. And then we find out, do we really trust in God like we say we do? And I believe without a doubt in my mind that whenever any individual begins to declare that they trust in God, that their words will be put to the test. And so, and that's not a bad thing. That is a good thing, because I don't want to just say it and not mean it. I want to know that my words have been tested, and that I've been through the trial, and that when I tell the Lord, I put my trust in thee, that it means something to him. Amen. But the last line here says, "I will not fear what flesh can do unto me." And this is where really my text is at, because I began to ponder at some things concerning the flesh. And here the psalmist says, "I will not fear what flesh can do unto me." And this can mean several things. First of all, can mean that I will not fear what people can do unto me, people that are created, any individual man or woman that's living is God's creation, and they are considered flesh. And the psalmist is saying that I put my trust in God. I will not fear what people can do unto me. I will not fear what flesh can do unto me. And I think that that, in my opinion, can be an easy thing to say for some people, and it may not always be, but just in my mindset, I'm not too much afraid of people or of what people can do unto me. There may be those who are stronger than me. There may be those who have more authority than I do. They have weapons and stronger position, and they are higher and they are over me. But that does not mean that I will fear them. And this is not the direction I'm going. Just hear me out for a second. But to another note, when it says, I will not fear what flesh can do unto me, have you ever considered what your own flesh can do unto you? Because when it comes to that type of mindset, then I have a real enemy. And my flesh, no, I don't fear my flesh, but let me tell you, my flesh can definitely be my number one enemy. I'm not going to give any praise to the devil today, but I want to talk to you about having an understanding of the flesh, an understanding of the flesh and the spirit. And what flesh can do to me, my own flesh can make me to believe lies. Have you ever been there? It can cause me to feel a certain way that I ought not to. It can cause me to feel a certain way about people, about situations, about a particular circumstance that's going on, and I don't like it. And my flesh can tell me all kinds of things that are not even so. Many times people even begin to play out the scenario of what's going on, or what could have went on, or what could have happened, or what could be. And the flesh does this to us. My flesh can get weak. My flesh can get sick. My flesh gets tired and it needs rest. And when our flesh doesn't have rest, then we are fatigued and we cannot operate or function properly within a day's work. We cannot function properly or give forth the amount of strength that we would when we are well rested. And so the flesh gets tired and it affects my function and my work ethic. It affects everything. It affects the way I think. It affects the way I talk. I can't think straight when I'm tired. And so the flesh does this to us. The flesh makes demands. It tells me when to drink, tells me when to eat, etc. The flesh does all these things to us. And you could identify, I'm sure. But spiritually also, this flesh, if listened to, can get us into trouble. It desires the forbidden. In Genesis chapter 3, we find that Adam and Eve ate of the forbidden fruit. Why is that? Why did they eat of the forbidden fruit? Because their flesh was tempted by the serpent. It was tempted to be as gods, to have knowledge of good and evil, to have their eyes open and their understanding opened. And, whenever our flesh is tempted, it is tempted for a reason. It is tempted with certain things that appease us. And what we never hear when we're tempted is the consequences. And so the flesh, when it's appeased, doesn't think of the consequences. And these are some things that the flesh can do to get us into trouble, that if we're not careful and we don't silence the voice of the flesh, then we will all give in to it. And it'll put us away from God. It'll put us in a situation that where we don't want to be, because now that we are born again and we are the people of God, we should want to do things that are pleasing unto God, that are pleasing unto His word. That if I love His word and I trust in Him and I praise His word, then I'm going to follow His word. But this flesh, on the other hand, is I've got to live with this thing. I wake up with it every day and I've got to tend to it. I've got to care for it. I've got to, sometimes I even got to talk to it and tell myself, come on, get yourself together. Let's do this, or motivate my own self. The Bible says that David encouraged himself in the Lord. And sometimes we've got to do that, you know, but spiritually this flesh, it can get us into trouble. And the reason is not necessarily the flesh itself, but sin that begins to reign in our mortal bodies, that begins to live in this flesh, that begins to desire things, that once your flesh has tasted of something, it will want more. Some of you could probably think of a particular food that's your favorite food. And once you have tasted it, your mind can bring back the experience. And whenever the scripture says, taste and see that the Lord is good, it's relating to our experience, not just tasting the Lord or taking a bite out of him. No, it's more pertaining to experiences of life. Because once I have tasted and seen, then it comes back to my memory. I can bring it back to my recollection. I can, it doesn't even have to be in front of me. I can think of eating pepperoni pizza and the flavor comes to my mouth. The smell can come back to my nose, and you know, all these things. There, people can eat a pickle and the sourness taste will come back, and you know, and the experience of it can just, it immediately appeases you, and you could almost smell it because of the experience. Have you ever tasted of victory? Victory is not something we eat, so to speak, but whenever an individual experiences victory, then they can say that I have tasted of victory. I can taste the glory of it. And so it relates to our experiences. And so when it comes to the flesh will desire things, and it will deal with our experiences. And so when sin comes into our life, it leaves a taste. It leaves a bad taste. And many times our flesh would like nothing more but then to give back into the things that it once participated in, to the things that it once loved, the things that it once was addicted to. And so, but then there are times that this flesh will actually even want God. Psalms chapter 84 and verse 2, the Bible reads, "My soul longeth, yea, even fainteth for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh crieth out for the living God." I want you to notice in Psalms 84 verse 2 that he separates that my heart and my flesh cries out for the living God. My heart doesn't mean the organ that pumps blood in my body. It's pertaining to my spirit. My spirit and my flesh cries out for the living God. Notice that the heart is separated from that, meaning that my spirit cries out for God, but so does my flesh. There's been times when people, including myself, we've gone on living for God and we've made a mistake, and afterward, the conviction, the heaviness, the guilt, it weighs on us, and we begin to cry. My flesh begins to cry out, because this is the thing, this is the vehicle that God has given me to live in. This is the body that my spirit dwells in. And so now my flesh cries out to God, even though this flesh is no good. Even though this flesh has messed me up a time or two, but this flesh also gets to a place that where it will cry out for the living God. And my soul within it, my soul burns for God. My soul yearns for God. The scripture says, as in a dry and thirsty land, so does my soul thirst after thee, O God, for the living God. Why? Because my soul is thirsty for him. My soul gets hungry for the word of God. Jesus said that no man can live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. That is my bread. It feeds my spirit. And me praying in the Holy Ghost, renewing myself in the Holy Ghost, is my drink, is my living water. This is my fresh water that will soothe my soul. And so the flesh, even though that it hinders us so many times, but it also can be a vehicle that cries out to God and reunites me back to the living God, so that way I can be right with God. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. I'm trying my best with the help of the Holy Ghost to give us an understanding of the flesh. An understanding of the flesh. In Romans chapter 7, we heard a little bit of this at camp. Verse 14, Romans 7 and 14. And he says, "For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin." That word carnal there means I am fleshly. I am a man. I am human being. I am a flesh. "For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that do I. If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. Now then, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwells in me. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh." You see, there it is right there in verse 18. "In my flesh dwells no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I find not. For the good that I would, I do not. But the evil which I would not, that I do." We've all been there, church. "Now if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me." And I want you to notice verse 20, that you can't just blame the devil on everything. He says, "Now if I do that something I know I wouldn't do or that I shouldn't, it is no more I that do it." I'm the one that done it. I'm the one that's to blame. And we've got to stop putting things on the enemy's credit or on the enemy's excuse or that it's the devil made me do it. No, I made me do it. I did it. And the scripture says, "But it is sin that dwells in me." Verse 21, "I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me." And how true that is, that every time I would try to do right, every time that I would try to do good, I've got some little voice in my ear saying, "No, you better not. No, you might as well just sit down. No, don't worship. No, don't get out of your chair." You've got to learn to silence that voice and hear the voice of God that says, "Come to me." Amen. "Come to me and I will come to you." If you come to Jesus and you resist the devil, the Bible says the devil will flee. And so we've got to learn to allow our ears to be sensitive unto the voice of God, to where we can start hearing God's voice more and not the enemy's voice, not our own humanity, not the voice of our flesh, but the voice of God. Amen. In verse 23, it says, 22, "For I delight in the law of God after the inward man, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members." That is my limbs, my arms, my legs. These are my members. And it says, "O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death?" Verse 25, "I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin." And so in Paul's case, this inward man delighted in the law of God. However, desire was not enough. And desire will never be enough. And don't get me wrong, desire is good, church. It's good to desire the things of God. It's good to desire church. It's good to desire growth. It's good to desire these things. But the will to do right is not the same as doing right. Wishing to be righteous, longing to be righteous, is not the same as righteousness. And so if I'm going to be righteous, I have got to act upon righteousness. I've got to do righteous deeds. If I'm going to be a good person, if I'm going to be a good Christian, then I've got to act like a good Christian and not just talk about it. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. It don't matter how many scriptures you can quote. Unless you can live the scripture, then it's up to you, of no benefit. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. And so if I'm going to live according to the word of God, then the book that is read within my heart, amen, must be displayed and exemplified to everybody that I come across. Praise God. Amen. I've got to live this word. I don't want to talk about it. I want to be about it. Amen. In the name of Jesus. And so in other words, the will to be right in God's sight does not make one right. The law of the mind is the rationalizing of circumstances around oneself and the satisfying of one's conscience. Every man or woman has a conscience. Every rational man, which is reason and logic, has a conscience. It approves that whatever he believes is right, and it condemns that which he believes to be wrong. A man can, in all good conscience, honoring the law of his mind, do that which is wrong and abomination to God and feel right about it. Paul was proof of this fact. When he persecuted the church, he did it thinking that he was doing exactly what God wanted him to do. However, his conscience was wrong, and so was he. It's just like the nation of Islam today that believe that they are right doing the things that they do, killing people, beheading them, and all the things that the Quran tells them to do. Their conscience is clear about their actions, but their conscience and their actions together are wrong. So it goes to show that reason and logic and the desire of a man can lead him astray. This is why we need the word of God, church. This is why we need the word of God, because our flesh can deceive us. Our flesh can lie to us. This is why it is so important that we know the word of God, that we're reading the scriptures, because my flesh, my emotions can lie to me. It can deceive me. How many times have you been wrong about a family member? How many times have you been wrong about somebody in church? You thought that they thought some way about you. You thought that this, and because of what you thought, it led our emotions to rise up, and then we begin to think some particular thoughts about them as well, because naturally in our flesh we will become defensive when we feel attacked, when we feel like someone is rising up against us. We get defensive. This defense mechanism rises up in our flesh when many times it doesn't need to. If we would just pray and give the situation to God and not overreact and not get out of hand or get out of sorts, we would be able to maintain our victory and our spiritual walk with God if we would just follow the word of God, if we would practice what we preach, if we would keep the word of God in our heart, that I might not sin against it. Praise God. But the flesh, on the other hand, does not think like that. The flesh is the carnal man, and the carnal man is enmity with God. It's the enemy of God. And so this is why we've got to resist the enemy, resist the flesh, listen to the word of God, and put it in our practice even when it doesn't feel good. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Woo, praise God. I hope that you're being blessed by this. I hope this brings you an understanding. You see, we've all done things that are maybe even currently, I pray not, involved in things that we shouldn't be. But if we're not careful, and the law of my mind will convince me that I'm okay. Romans chapter 7, verse 22. I'm going to read it again. It says, "For I delight in the law of God after the inward man." You see, I have a desire to please God. And I know that you have a desire to please God. The desire is there. There's no question about that. You wouldn't come to church if you didn't have the desire. There have been many. How many have come to church lately and been baptized, but we haven't seen them? The desire is there. You know, the Bible, Paul said, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Amen. And then verse 23, he said, "But I see another law of my members warring against the law of my mind, bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members, my limbs, my body parts. They war against my mind, telling me to do things, to give in to things. And it goes against my desire." It goes against my desire. I have a desire to please God, but sometimes my emotions get the best of me and I forget my desire. I forget my desire to please God. I forget my desire to be a Christian, to be a man of God, because I get out of sorts sometimes. Come on, relate it to your own life. You know, and what does it do? It brings us into captivity. It brings us into a prison. And that's why it says there in verse 23, you need to read this in your Bible. It says, I see another law of my members warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity. It imprisons me. And you know how many people stay in prison of their mind because they've done things, they've said things, and they feel like that they just can't move on from there. And so they're captivated. They're imprisoned by their own thoughts and by their yesterdays and by their past. And so they just can't seem to get over that situation that they messed up in. And so it puts me into captivity, just like the scripture says. I don't think that we understand that many times, and that we put ourselves into that place of prison, that place of condemnation, where we have the power by the Spirit of God to free ourselves from that, to break every chain of the adversary. Amen. And so to get an understanding of the power of the flesh, I want you to hear this out and just brainstorm with me for a minute. Listen to this. You know, when Jesus Christ came, he was God Almighty in the flesh. Amen. But God himself, when he was in the garden, prayed three times, Lord, if it be possible, remove this cup from me. Why is that? Why did he have to pray continuously in this situation? You know, he sent himself in flesh, and just maybe now he finally understood the struggle that you and I have, because the flesh is so strong. And so my question to you is, why is the flesh so strong? Why was it ever so strong, such a strong entity, that it would be something that we fight on a day-to-day basis? And you know, God woke me up to this, and I found myself asking him that question. And I said, God, why is the flesh so strong? And he answered me, and this is what he said. He said, because I created it. Wow. I never looked at it that way. I mean, it's simple, but I never looked at it that way. That he gave us this terrestrial body so we could not defeat the flesh on our own. He created it, and everything that God created, he created it strong. Think about it. The stars in the sky, when they glimmer, they give God praise. Everything that he created, all creation praises God. When the wind blows and the trees sway back and forth, it's giving God praise. When the ocean comes in and the tide comes in and the waves roll, it is giving God praise, bowing down unto its creator. And so this flesh, being something strong, has to be broken and brought down. And when it is giving God praise, because we cannot defeat it. And so it is strong in a sense that we have to fight it, because God created it to be immortal in the beginning. And so when he created this thing to be immortal, all of a sudden sin entered in, and sin was stronger than the flesh. Wow. So when sin entered in, then the flesh would desire to feed off of it. The lust of the flesh. The Bible says all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, all that is in the world. In those three categories, it wants those things. It feeds off of those things, and it wants nothing more but to give back into those very things. And this is why the scripture says we must mortify or kill the deeds of the flesh. And we do that by the Spirit of God, because the Spirit of God has always been stronger than flesh and sin. Praise God. And so that is why God got that understanding, I believe, in the garden. Amen. He got that understanding, that because he was God Almighty and God is a spirit, and the spirit, amen, was stronger than that. And so he got up from his temptation. He got up from his prayer, and he went back to his friends and he said, sleep on. I don't need you anymore. Whew, my Lord Jesus. It was time to die. And this thing that he was wrapped in was his own creation. But at the time of him praying, he did not want to die. The flesh did not want to die. He realized the battle that we have with the flesh, that it doesn't want to die. It wants to live. It wants to grow. It wants to feed off of these things. But he went willingly to the cross to die for the sins of the world. John 1:29, he died for the sin of all the world. But he gave everybody an opportunity to come to him. Amen. But also to give us an example that as he died for the sin of the world, so we should also be dead to sin. That sin will no longer reign in our mortal bodies. That it will no longer live within us. Amen. And so that's the way we've got to look at sin. That it doesn't even live in me. It doesn't even exist in me. It is dead to me. Amen. Sin is dead to me. And if sin is dead to me, I should have no desire for the taste. I should have no desire for the experience. I should have no memory of it. And I know that's difficult sometimes. But let me tell you something. When you start putting your desire upon God, amen, I get a new mind. Amen. I'm renewed in my mind to live for Jesus Christ. And so the things that I desire now, I desire the things that be of him, the things that will please him. Amen. Praise God. Romans chapter 6 and verse number 1. And the word of God reads, "What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound?" Verse 2, "God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein?" Praise God. And that's how we've got to live. We've got to live as if we are dead to sin. No, I don't have a sin problem anymore. No, I've got a praise. I've got a praise problem. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. I don't have any sin problem. I don't desire to sin. I don't desire to be away from God or separate from God. I don't desire, to be in a place where I don't have the anointing, where I don't have the power of the Holy Ghost upon my life. I don't like being in a place where I feel like I can't pray for nobody or that I'm hindered or in these things. I want to see miracles, signs, and wonders. I want to know that when I lay hands on somebody that God's going to move. Amen. When I speak, that when I move, that God's going to move and that things are going to happen in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to have that confidence. And the only way we're going to have that is to understand that I cannot live with the mindset that I can defeat the flesh on my own. No, I've got to have the power of God. I've got to have the renewal of the Holy Ghost daily living within me. Praise the name of Jesus. Verse number 3, let me get back to our scriptures. Romans 6 and 3, "Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death?" And so that's important to know, because there's a lot of people who are not baptized in Jesus' name that think that they're dead to sin. I'm sorry, you're not. Because unless you have been baptized into Christ, then you are not in the likeness of his death. You need to be baptized in Jesus' name. Why? That is putting the old man to death. It is burying the old body. It is putting the flesh to death. Amen. And so I am risen with him when I come out of the water. Verse 4, "Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life." And so when I come out of that water, I am risen to newness of life. I am a new person. I am not that old person. I'm not that old man anymore. Verse 5, "For if," there is a condition here, "for if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection." And so I have put this body to death in a watery grave. Amen. And I went down in Jesus' name. And now I will also be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man, the old person, is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Praise God. Amen. And so now that I have the Holy Ghost living within me, amen, I can overcome this flesh. I am a new person. Amen. I am dead to sin. I am freed from that. Amen. And so I've got to do more than just having a desire. Amen. You see, we needed more than just a desire to do good. We needed the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Amen. So that way, the same spirit that raised Jesus, whoo, the same spirit that resurrected him, that raised him from the dead, is now living in you and I by the power of the Holy Ghost. Amen. And that is not true for you if you have not received the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. We've got to have that evidence. There will be a change. There will be a something take place in your life to give you proof that the Spirit of God is dwelling in you. Amen. I have scripture for that. Romans chapter 8 and verse 8. It says, "So then, they that are in the flesh cannot please God." Amen. Notice that if you are in the flesh, you cannot please God. There's a lot of people that say they go to church. There's a lot of people that say they're Christians, but they don't have the Spirit of God. And so therefore, they're not walking in the Spirit. They're not living in the Spirit. And so in the flesh, they cannot please God. It doesn't matter how many good deeds they do. They cannot please God in the flesh. Verse 9, he says, but you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, capital S, Holy Ghost. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you, if the Spirit of God dwell in you, now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. So that puts to silence all of those that say, well, we're all God's children. We're all God's children. No, we're not. If you don't have the Spirit of Christ, then you are none of his. You need to be born again. John chapter 3, verse 5, unless a man is born again of water and spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Praise God. Let's go back to Romans chapter 8 and verse number 10. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. Verse 11, but if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken or raise up your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwells in you. Praise God. Amen. And so it doesn't matter if I'm here for the Lord's coming or if I pass away and I go to the grave. One thing for sure is that the same Spirit that raised up Jesus will also raise me up too. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. We cannot live without the Holy Ghost. We cannot be saved without the Holy Ghost. This flesh, you have to have an understanding that the flesh is strong because God created it. But he also made a way for us to overcome it, and that was by his Spirit. And not our spirit, by his Spirit. His Spirit alone, amen, is the only way we will have the power to overcome it. Amen. Anyone who thinks they can be saved without the Holy Ghost does not know the truth. Amen. And definitely doesn't even have an understanding of the flesh, because they think that they can live for God, amen, in the flesh. And that is not so, because the scripture tells us that if you are in the flesh, you cannot please God. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. I'm getting excited here because I've got an understanding of the flesh and I have an understanding of the Spirit. Amen. And once I have this understanding, amen, I can have revelation. I can pray and go to the depths of prayer. I can intercede for my brothers and sisters. I can know the mind of the Spirit. Amen. Because I make intercession for the saints. Amen. I can know what the mind of the Spirit is for my family. I can speak, thus saith the Lord. Amen. I can hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Amen. I have eyes to see and ears to hear. Why? Because my understanding has been opened. Amen. And I have an understanding. I don't live according to the flesh anymore, but I live according to the Spirit and by the Word of God. And therefore, God can lead me and guide me into all truth. Praise God. In the name of Jesus. And so it doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter what you're doing. It doesn't matter your circumstance. It doesn't matter your monetary situation. God can come in to your life and bring complete and total change, amen, and give you power to overcome any situation by his Spirit. Remember, it's always by his Spirit and nothing else. Amen. This is why the scripture says that it is not by might, not by power, but by his Spirit, saith the Lord. Amen. By his Spirit. That's the way we're going to do it. No weapon formed against me shall prosper, because I have the Spirit of God. Amen. And when I have the Spirit of God, I am made more than an overcomer. I am more than conquerors through the blood of Jesus Christ. Praise God. I pray that this is encouraging you. I pray that this is giving you an understanding to know that we have the truth of the Word of God. We that have the Holy Ghost, amen, we have rights. Amen. We've got benefits. Amen. That no matter what situation we find ourselves in, we have a protection. We have a covering. Amen. We have the Spirit of God. We have a hedge about our church. Praise God. Amen. In the name of Jesus. And we have a right, amen, to declare certain things. We have a right to pray over our family, amen, and declare that they are healed in Jesus' name. We have a right, amen, to pray things over our church, that God would protect it and God would be with us and God would be upon us and make us prosperous as our soul would prosper. Praise the name of Jesus. Amen. Praise God. Amen. I hope this is encouraging you. I hope you're being blessed. I pray that the Word of God would be rich to your spirit tonight. I want you to know, to be encouraged, that in Jesus' name, God is for us. And if God be for us, who can be against us? Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. An understanding of the flesh and spirit. I pray this has blessed your soul. I'm getting excited. I better stop before I keep you for another hour. But I want you to know, amen, that we've got to overcome this flesh. We've got to overcome the enemy. There ought not be any such thing as, oh, I slipped up, or and don't get me wrong, I know we're not perfect. We're going to make mistakes. But we have the Spirit of the living God living within us. We are new people. We are new creatures. We should have new mindsets, new attitudes. Amen. New outlook on life. We are blessed, church. We live good lives. Praise God. We live good lives. God is good to us. We are different people. We are not who we used to be. We are new. We are changed. We are blessed. And I am thankful to God for all that he is doing and all that he has given us. Amen. God bless you tonight. I pray this has ministered to you. I pray this helps you. Amen. To God be the glory, in Jesus' name. Amen.